The most awesome words ever spoken on planet Earth were spoken by the most awesome person after the most awesome prophecy about the most awesome place. Despite an awesome problem and an awesome plan and an awesome promise. You have Bibles or have it on the screen? Turn to Matthew 28. Matthew chapter 28. Luke, in his writing to in the book of Acts, said he was simply continuing what the Lord Jesus Christ had begun to do and teach after his passion, when he showed himself alive with many infallible proofs. And of all the appearances of our risen Lord after his resurrection, the subject this morning has to do with that most glorious appearance of the resurrected Lord. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18, we have these most awesome words. A person standing on planet Earth says in verse 18, and Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Very presumptuous for anyone to stand on planet Earth and say, I have all authority over this entire planet. But for someone to stand on this planet and say, I have all authority in heaven and on earth. It's the most awesome words I can think of. We would expect that the most awesome words be spoken by the most awesome person, our Lord Jesus Christ. Like the songwriter says, the whole world was lost in the darkness of sin. The light of the world is Jesus. Like sunshine at noonday, his glory shone in. The light of the world is Jesus. Come to this light, 'tis shining for thee. Sweetly the light has dawned upon me. Once I was blind, but now I can see. The light of the world is Jesus. Amen. John chapter 1 and verse 4, we read that after John says Jesus was with God in the beginning, that Jesus was God, we read that in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shined in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There was a man, that's John the Baptist, sent from God, whose name was John. This man came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light which lights everyone coming into the world. Jesus is the light of every aspect of this world and this life in which we live. He's the light of the financial world. Lay up treasures in heaven. He's the light of the social world. Love your neighbor. He's the light of the educational world. In him are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, the scripture said. He's the light of the scientific world. He upholds all things by the word of his power. Every atom in the entire universe is held together by the Lord Jesus Christ. Every electron spinning around a neutron and a proton. We have the splitting of the atom. We have the atomic bomb. Jesus holds it all together, dear friend. Jesus is the light of the political world. How we need light here today. Scripture says, let every soul be subject to the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. Name whatever area we may, the only light in the darkness of this world is the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus says in John 3:19, this is the condemnation. That light himself has come into the world, but people love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. Most of all, Jesus is the light of the spiritual world. He's the only way, the only truth, and the only life. Awesome words spoken by this most awesome person, fulfilling a most awesome prophecy. Look at Isaiah chapter 9. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 1, we read these words, middle of the verse, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterward, more heavily, we'll skip to the next phrase there. And by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, in Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. And then verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. He goes to speak of his reign here on this earth. This was fulfilled in Matthew chapter 4 in the New Testament. Matthew chapter 4 and verses 14 through 16. We read that Jesus came into the Zebulun and Naphtali that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way, beyond the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and upon those who sat in the region in shadow of death, light has dawned. Point to Matthew 4, verses 23 and 25. And Jesus went about all Galilee. How many times so far have we mentioned that word Galilee? Teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people. And then verse 25, great multitudes followed him from Galilee and from Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and beyond the Jordan. But go to chapter 26 of Matthew and verse 32. Before Jesus went to the cross, he prophesied concerning this time when he would make these most awesome words. Matthew chapter 26, verse 32. And after I have been raised I will go before you into Galilee. Galilee of the Gentiles, Galilee of the nations. Then go to chapter 28 in Matthew. Not only do we have Isaiah and Jesus prophesying of this occasion, but we have an angel at the open tomb. Matthew 28, verse 22, when behold, there was a great earthquake, and an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. Verse 5, but the angel answered and said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and indeed, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. And if that's not enough prophecy, listen to the risen Lord himself. In verse 10, and Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee. And there they shall see me. What an awesome prophecy. Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing if we could be assured that we'd see Jesus here today? Well, look at this awesome place. 28, verse 16. Then the 11 disciples went away where? To the mountain. Wouldn't it be wonderful if Brookwood Baptist Church was a mountaintop experience for all of us each Sunday morning? Everybody, the Galilee of the nations, the Galilee of the Gentiles, to the mountain. Like Pastor says, each Sunday morning at 11 o'clock, this should be our mountaintop. This should be our mountain experience with our Lord in worship, realizing his presence and his power in our lives. Notice verse 16. Not only into Galilee, not only to a mountain, but which Jesus had appointed for them. The creator of the universe created a very special mountain for his people to come and see his risen presence. This is the most awesome place. But dear friends, it's the most awesome place whenever or where Jesus has appointed us. Which Jesus had appointed for them. The 11 o'clock hour for Brookwood Baptist Church is the hour where Jesus appoints for us to meet him, to see him, to realize, as his promise is, where we gather in his name, there am I in the midst of them. A most awesome place. But next we have a most awesome promise. Our most awesome problem. Most awesome problem. In the verse 16. All right, going into verse 17. When they saw him, you know, when we're where Jesus has appointed us, there's spontaneous worship. They worshiped him, verse 17. But the awesome promise, some doubted. Some doubted. There was the risen Savior with the prince in his hand and the wound in his side. And he says, look at me. See me as the one who died for you and rose again for your justification to declare. Shamdag. Dear friends, this is the only sin that leads to the hell prepared for the devil and his angels. Holy Spirit comes to us today and says, see the Savior of the world. See the risen Lord. Hear his gracious invitation. Come unto me, all ye ends of the earth, and be ye saved. Isaiah 45:22. Peter says there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Paul says this is a faithful saying worthy that everyone accepts it. That Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Apostle Paul is one of the most religious people of his time. But he said, God had mercy on him because he did it in ignorance. And God saved him from such a wicked life that he had to be a pattern for all of us on how great the grace of God is. The Apostle Paul, when meeting Christ on the road to Damascus, realizing who Jesus was, said, Lord, what will you have me to do? He testified that God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in my heart to give a light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. God used the Apostle Paul to write, if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God hath raised him from the dead, we will be saved. For with the heart we believe unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Have you confessed him today, dear friend, with your mouth? Have you believed in your heart in the risen Savior? You have his absolute assurance. You have eternal salvation. Reservation in heaven, if you do. Finally, the most awesome plan. Disciple every nationality and teach them to disciple every nationality. There in verse 19, Jesus said, I have this all this authority and I'm giving it all to you. Secure their discipleship through baptism, identifying with him in his death and resurrection. Secure their fellowship with you in the Lord at the Lord's Supper. And teach them to observe everything else I have commanded you. You have all the authority in heaven and on earth to build my church. Do all you can possibly do in all the ministries of Brookwood Baptist Church. You have more authority to do that and more responsibility to do that than you have to do anything else on planet Earth. Jesus says, since he has all authority in heaven, everything we do here on earth will enhance our heaven experience, our heavenly experience. Every single thing we do for Jesus here on this planet, for just this moment of time, so to speak, will enhance all eternity for each one of us. Finally, friends, we have an awesome promise. Verse 20, lo, I am with you always. You want to experience the presence of Jesus? Do his work. Be about his business. Build his church. Work with his people. Love his church and give yourself for it like Jesus does, the scripture says. And he says, you'll know my presence. Lo, I am with you. I'd rather have Jesus with me than anyone or anything else. How about you, dear friend? As we come to the Lord's table this morning, we testify to our fellowship with him. Is there anything between your soul and the Savior? Any unconfessed sin? Anything we need to get right before God? Let's understand his presence today. because we follow his word at this table. If we want to know his presence continually, let's be about his work constantly. Pastor.